And Taurus is also rich in deep sky objects. Of course, the major star is Aldebaran, and then there's Hyades and the Pleiades, which are two clusters now. You can see better in this actual image of them. There's Aldebaran, here is the Hyades, and here's the Pleiades. Now, they're both open clusters of stars. And the Hyades at one time looked like the Pleiades. The Pleiades formed together. A group of massive stars were formed together, and they're still closely associated. But they will slowly, over time, start to, they will develop their own, they all have their own proper motions. And they will not be so gravitationally bound. Little as they get close to each other, the little slingshotty back to give one a little bit of motion in a different direction. Eventually, they will all wander away from the open cluster. And that is what has happened with the Hyades. It's a much older cluster. The stars are not reflecting blue like these are. They're older, they're dimmer. The radiation is not as intense, and they're not so closely associated anymore. Also in this area in Taurus is the Crab Nebula, which is a supernova remnant with a pulsar in the center. This is a composition. The pulsar, the Crab pulsar, is a Chandra X-ray image of X-ray, and the red is from Spitzer, so that's the infrared part of the supernova remnant. And then the yellow and the green is from Hubble, the optical components. There is also, in this area, a planet is forming, close to being formed, that is the youngest forming planet that's been observed to date, and it is thought that this planet is going to be in the order of magnitude of about 14 Jovian masses. Then we have Ursa Major and Ursa Minor, Big Bear, Little Bear, or with the Dipper asterisms that we're familiar with. And of course, Polaris is the brightest star in Ursa Minor. And in Ursa Major, the two stars that you're responsible for, Mizar and Alcor, and you see here is Mizar, it's in the handle, but you can almost see that there's a second star there. Usually you have to go, here's a chart that shows both Mizar and Alcor. And you'll notice this is reversed from the image that was here before. So those are two stars together, not just one. And in this same region of the sky is a supernova, a 1993J, that happened in the M81 galaxy. Right there is that supernova event. We have Gamma Velorum, which is a multiple star system in the Vela remnant. A multiple star is six stars together, and one of those is a Wolf Rayet star. And this is the Vela supernova remnant in the same region, and it has a pulsar in the center. That is an X-ray. Pulsars are so small, and so even though they're very hot, they're very small, very faint, and you need X-rays and sometimes gamma rays to detect them. Virgo with Spica, and no, that was Jupiter, not Spica, the brightest star in that constellation. Part two, stellar evolution. As we said, you need to have a fundamental basic understanding that stars, protostars, form out of gas and dust and star-forming complexes and stellar nurseries. Depending upon their mass, they go through a sequence of evolutionary stages from protostars to main sequence stars where hydrogen is fusing into helium. Then when they run out of hydrogen in the core, they start to evolve. For sun-sized stars, they'll go through a red giant stage, planetary nebula, and a white dwarf. If a white dwarf happens to be in a binary system, it might accrete enough material from its companion star for a thermonuclear event, which is a type 1a supernova. If it is more massive, it will become a red supergiant, undergo a core collapse into a type 2 supernova event, and leave behind either a neutron star, pulsar, magnetar, or a black hole. You need a basic understanding of spectra. For instance, here's the spectra from the Sun, a G2 star, Arcturus, K1, Procyon, F5. This is the hottest ones, and this one's a little bit cooler, and then this one's a little bit cooler still. You don't see a lot of difference between those spectra, though, do you? On just visual inspection of it. So what they do is condense all of that spectra into one little bar. Here's Procyon F5, here's F5. So they take every one of these lines, and with all the absorption lines, and they make one that shows just the major dominant lines that are indicative of that particular temperature of a star. So we have, and those lines, those absorption lines, some of them are Balmer lines, some of them are Fraunhofer lines. Whatever the temperature of the star is, that determines what the spectral lines are going to look like, and they're very unique to every single temperature, has its own little fingerprint of a spectral to determine what its classification is. And once they determine what the spectra is of a star, they can plot it on the HR diagram, which is a plot of either absolute magnitude or luminosity versus temperature or spectral class. And when they plot it, and this is a scattergram type of a plot, then they know its age, its chemical composition, its temperature, what its mass is, when it was a protostar, what its mass was when it hit the main sequence, how long it's going to last on the main sequence, and its entire evolutionary history is known from looking at where it is on this HR diagram. So here's the main sequence. These have stars that evolved the red giant branch, like the sun will one day. These are where the supergiants like Betelgeuse is, that have evolved over from the main sequence horizontally to the supergiant branch. Down here we have the white dwarfs, which are left behind. Once these red giants collapse, form the planetary nebula, which drifts slowly away over time, and ends up with a white dwarf, which is located in this particular part of the HR diagram. And this is a visual, look again, this is a more of a scientific plot of this visual representation of stellar evolution. These are the protostars. These stars are laying on the main sequence. This is on the giant branch. This is on the supergiant branch. And the white dwarfs have their own branch on the HR diagram. So understand spectral images. You might be asked to understand the spectral plot, which is the scientific way that calculations are done with spectra. The absorption lines match up with the absorption lines that you see in the image, but the plot is easier to go straight down to the line and determine what the wavelength of that absorption line is, because that tells you what the temperature is, and that will tell you what the chemical composition is, and that will tell you what the classification of that star is. When you superimpose them, you can see how they match up perfectly. So we have the hydrogen-Balmer lines that you can then overlay right on top and see that they match up quite well. That tells you a lot about the temperature of the star. When the Balmer lines don't match up, sometimes there are other lines that you can use, like this double calcium line right here, match up perfectly with these two absorption lines right here. That tells you that that is a G-type star with a surface temperature of approximately 5,000 to 6,000 K. So make sure you collect your images in different wavelengths. For instance, here's Cas A, the supernova remnant in radio. Here it is in infrared. Here it is in optical. And of course, the stars that are between us and it that are in the field of view. This is a Hubble image, also show up because you're only looking at the optical component. This one is all X-ray colorized by energy. So the blue is the most iron, the most energetic. The green is the medium energy silicon elements, and then you have the less energetic colorization also, and you see that gives you a good eye. On this one, you can see the outer shock wave, the inner shock wave. You can see this jet of silicon being thrown out here. You can't see any of those features in the optical or in the infrared or in the radio. This one is a composite image, many of them are. The blue is the X-ray. The red is the infrared from Spitzer, and the yellow and the green is the optical from Hubble. So pay attention to the wavelengths of your images. You also